Whereas the average response time for first responders once 911 is called is 8 to 12 minutes, almost 90% of the people who suffer out-of-hospital cardiac arrest die. Did you hear that? 90%. Cardiopulmonary resuscitation, CPR, especially if performed in the first few minutes of cardiac arrest, can double or triple a person's chance of survival. Whereas an automatic external defibrillator, an AED, is the only effective treatment for restoring a regular heart rhythm during sudden cardiac arrest, and it is an easy to operate tool for anyone with no medical background. For each minute defibrillation is delayed, the chance of survival is reduced by approximately 10%. Whereas Steve Rusek, a Public Works Department employee for the Borough of Bethel Park since August 3, 1998, received the life-saving CPR and AED training on October 27, 2016 by the Tri-Community South EMS. Mr. Rusek, like many or all individuals, hoped he would never need to use his certification, but he was confident that he was properly trained. Whereas on June the 7th, at the Bethel Park Community Center in this building, Mr. Rusek was on duty when a man complained of shortness of breath. As emergency services were called, the man's condition quickly deteriorated. Soon he had no pulse and was not breathing. Mr. Rusek quickly stepped into action, began administering CPR to the individual experiencing cardiac arrest. Chest compressions along with the AED were used on the Bethel Park resident to restart his heart. Mr. Rusek continued to do compressions until the emergency services arrived on the scene. Now, therefore, be it resolved that Allegheny County Council does hereby commend and recognize Mr. Steve Rusek for his heroic actions on June 7, 2017, which resulted in the saving the life of a Bethel Park resident. It is people like Mr. Rusek that reinforce the message and increase the awareness of all the Americans that people trained in CPR and AED can be an effective means of reducing mortality from heart attacks. Sponsored this day by myself, Sue Means, Sam DeMarco, and Tom Baker, presented on August 31st, 2017. Hey, I'm a nurse, and I've never had to do CPR, never. And I hope that I will be brave and rise to the occasion as you did and administer life-saving technique to save one. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Sue. Appreciate it. First up, our presenter, John Quinlisk, is talking about MS4. John, I'll turn the microphone over to you at this time.
Good evening. Thank you for coming out. As John mentioned, I'm going to talk about the MS4 program, and that's a stormwater management program. MS4 stands for Municipal Separate Stormwater System. So, let's see if I get this thing to work. Okay, it worked before. Technical difficulties. So while Sean's adjusting that, there's two types of stormwater systems. Separate stormwater systems, where sanitary sewage is one pipe and stormwater is in a second pipe. That's what Bethel Park has. We have a separate system. Other communities in the area have a combined system where sewage and stormwater are in a single pipe. So this is specifically for a separate system. There you go. So the technical definition of an MS4 is a conveyance system, which could be a ditch, a road, curbs, gutters, storm drains that are owned by a public body, so it's a municipal separate storm system. It's designed for collecting or conveying stormwater, and it's not part of a combined sewer system, as I described earlier, and it's not part of a publicly owned treatment works like the wastewater treatment plant we have in Piney Fork. So that's the definition of an MS4. And the question comes up, are there certain areas in Bethel Park that have an MS4 designation? The question is, all of Bethel Park has an MS4 designation. And we have four main watersheds in Bethel Park. Sawmill Run, which is up on the top of the drawing there towards the northeast. Brush Run, which is down in the southwest corner. Lower Chartiers Creek. And when you think of Chartiers Creek, I think further west near Bridgeville and Interstate 70, or 79, excuse me. But we have part of our streams actually go into Lower Chartiers Creek, and then Piney Fork Creek, which runs down through Clifton Road into Simmons Park. So those are the four main watersheds that we focused on. And we have this what's called an NPDES permit, National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System. And that's just a regulatory term for a water pollution permit. So we have a permit to discharge stormwater. And based on that permit, we have six minimum control measures that we need to implement. So I'll go through this briefly. Public education and outreach, which is what we're doing tonight, explaining how the system works to the public. Public involvement and participation, inviting people to participate in efforts that would help with controlling stormwater pollution. Illicit discharge detection and elimination. So for example, if someone was dumping something illegally into the storm system, we would find the source of that and stop it. Construction site stormwater runoff control, that's a big issue, eliminating erosion and sedimentation. After the construction, number five, how do you manage stormwater post-construction? And then finally, pollution prevention and good housekeeping in our municipal system. So I kind of went through those briefly, but in detail, we're required to make a yearly public presentation. Today is one of them. I'm also organizing another one that's going to come up later in the fall. That's going to be more broadly based on stormwater issues. We post articles in the Bethel Park Chronicles. We have educational pamphlets. There are some in the back you may have seen on the way in. And that's also posted on our website with other information on our website and on our Facebook page. And when developers are planning projects, we meet with them to discuss management of stormwater during construction, so we're not, we're controlling erosion, so there's minimal sedimentation going into the streams, and also, like I mentioned earlier, post-construction management. So people might not understand the way a storm sewer system works, but anything that goes into a storm sewer, like a grate along the side of the road, it eventually gets into the stream. So if, you know, years ago people changed their own oil, now we go to a service like that, but if people change their oil and say, I'm just going to dump it down this storm grate, no problem. Well, that goes to a stream. So part of the concept is to get people to understand that. We're working with other groups in the area. Sawmill Run Watershed Association, for the portion of our community that's in Sawmill Run. We're working with them on a team effort to try to promote stormwater management in that area. The Allegheny Watershed Alliance, who's planning a tree planting in South Park coming up in the middle of October. So the tree planting will be along Catfish Run, which will help to control runoff in that vicinity and improve the water quality. Again, I mentioned public presentations, information on our website. And then, again, we enforce our municipal stormwater ordinance to control stormwater management. If there is a problem, if there's something besides water coming out of our storm system into the streams, we have people that are trained to sample that water and try to track where the source of that discharge came from so we can eliminate it and then take enforcement action if necessary. So that picture there is a stormwater management system during construction that's not actually functioning like it should. All that muddy water should not be going into the catch basin there. It should be stopped. So the Allegheny County Conservation District has the authority to enforce that, but we cooperate with them on inspections and enforcement procedures to eliminate problems such as this. after construction, after the mud's all gone and the grass has grown, you still have to manage that stormwater. People that live on the top of the hill, their water goes to the bottom of the hill. And the people, unfortunately, at the bottom of the hill, sometimes it's not a benefit to them. Sometimes it's a detriment. So we do our best to manage that post-construction stormwater management. And the sixth minimum control measure is good housekeeping. So in our public facilities, we do our best to manage our procedures and processes that would impact stormwater. One of those would be street sweeping. And this might not come to your mind readily, but street sweeping is a stormwater management tool. The more debris we can clean off the streets, you know, if we don't clean it off, it goes into the storm system, goes into the streams. So all that sediment loading or oil and grease or whatever might happen to be in the street can affect the aquatic life and decrease the water quality. So we have an O&M plan for our municipal facilities to prevent stormwater pollution, and we do annual employee training, which is coming up in September, to discuss this program specifically. So we just finished preparing for those four main watersheds that I mentioned. We've finished preparing a pollutant prevention plan for each of those, and the plan has a target of reducing sediment loadings in streams by 10% and phosphorus loadings by 5%. And that was publicly advertised for comment, and now I'm in the process of preparing to submit that to Pennsylvania DEP for their review and approval. And that will kick into our next 5 years of our NPDES permit, our water pollution permit. So that will be submitted within the next few weeks to DEP. And as I mentioned, we are inspecting BMP's best management practices that control stormwater pollution. We're inspecting those throughout the municipality. We're looking at stormwater outfalls where the end of the pipe discharges into the stream and inspecting that to see if there's any problems, any illicit discharges. Public education, again, like tonight, and stormwater training for our employees. So that's what we're doing as a municipality. In addition to the stormwater plans that I mentioned that we're implementing here over the next few years, and we have a brief rundown of the four watersheds and what we're doing. In addition to street sweeping and cleaning our catch basins, which is a normal operation, in Sawmill Run, we're planning a stream restoration project with an estimated cost of about $9,000. And we're working with the Sawmill Run Watershed Association on an integrated watershed management plan. In Brush Run, which borders Peters Township, we have a very small land area there. So we're actually teaming up with Peters Township and working on a cooperative project, stream restoration project of an estimated cost of about $4,000 for our portion of it. And stream restoration is just improving the way the stream flows so that the banks don't erode. And when they erode, they cause more sediment to go into the stream. So we're trying to, there's natural stream design approaches that you can use to make the stream flow in such a manner that it doesn't erode. And that's our primary focus on all of these projects. Lower Chartiers Creek, near the high school football stadium, there, Peter Page Park, there's a stream that goes through there. We have about $99,000 estimated for a stream restoration project there. And Piney Fork Creek in the vicinity of Simmons Park, we're doing a similar project. And that's a little bit bigger effort of $168,000. And all this will decrease the sediment loading and decrease the phosphorus loading in those streams. And like I said, I'm going to submit that to DEP within the next couple of weeks. Now, as residents of Bethel Park, what can you do? Well, I'm glad you asked. Thank you. There are things to do when you're managing your own property. If you're applying pesticides or fertilizers, control the rate of application. You just be careful to not overdo it, because a lot of that pesticide or fertilizer won't be absorbed by plants if there's excessive amounts, and it will go off when it rains in the runoff into the streams and might have a detrimental effect on the water quality and the aquatic life. The second item, never pour chemicals, motor oil, or fuel, or any foreign substance into a drainage grate in the street. That doesn't go to the sanitary sewer, that goes to the storm sewer, which is a direct connection to the stream. So it'd be just like going down to the stream and pouring a gallon of oil directly into the stream. It's not a good thing. If you have a swimming pool or a hot tub, it's best to drain those into grassy areas and let that soak into the ground. You could also drain that into the sanitary system, but it's definitely not something we want to put in the storm system. In the wintertime, salt is important for public safety and people walking up and down your driveway, or getting your car out of your driveway and walking up and down your sidewalk. But at the same time, we don't want to overdo it because, again, that salt will flow into the streams. So we want to keep things safe, but at the same time, control the amount. And if you have grass cuttings or you're raking leaves, don't dump those into a storm drain or a waterway. It just causes more problems. That's a real brief summary and an overview of the MS4 program. And there are a lot of other issues pertaining to stormwater, but we wanted to focus on this one in particular tonight. So if you have any questions, I can take those now, or we can talk about it later on as well. Yes? Typically, it comes from fertilizer. Fertilizer typically contains nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. And phosphorus is the target item for DEP at this point. So if you overapply fertilizer, you're probably putting extra phosphorus into the water system. Sir? As far as applying salt, would that be a better question for the Public Works folks?
Yeah. Okay. So one method we use to control salt in the wintertime, actually we're in the process of purchasing what's called an AccuBrine system. The AccuBrine system allows us to pre-wet roads. The nice thing about it is the salt material sticks to the roadway and doesn't bounce off. So typical application of salt, it bounces off fairly easily off the roadway. So this new AccuBrine system is going to allow us to get that pre-wet condition. Also, we can mix regular salt with the water on the truck as it's coming out to eliminate that bouncing off the roadway. So our new trucks do have that capability to add that wetted material to the salt so that we prevent that bounce and spread.
And your second question about monitoring the paved areas? Typically, those parking lots drain into some type of basin that catches that flow and then slows it down. And that's so.
Basically, if someone checks the catch basin to make sure they're always flowing and not backing up.
When we note that one is backing up, or we receive a call that one's backing up, we inspect it, clean it out. If necessary, we can televise it and look for blockages.
We do drive around and monitor the storm drains throughout the system with our public works crew. Specifically, a lot of times before rain events, we'll drive around making sure that the debris and stuff's cleaned off. Can we open up to questions? Anybody else? Yes, sir, in red.
You have a good point there. Anytime there's a direct drainage to the surface, you need to consider, where's that water going to go, and is it going to affect my neighbor? So it's not a blanket statement that we should always disconnect downspouts, but if it's feasible and if it makes sense, it helps, because that water then soaks into the ground and also runs off. Even if it gets to the stream, it runs off more slowly, and that limits flooding. Yes? If you see something backing up on the roadway, please let us know. Your eyes and ears, in addition to the staff we have out every day, don't hesitate to let us know.
Yeah,
Well, as we clean the catch basins, I mean, we notice it then, but oftentimes that is on a rotating schedule and we don't always see a situation. So, yeah, please let us know. Yes, in the back. You know, we've talked about it. I don't know if we have an official program at this point, but that's certainly one of the practices we can encourage and implement. What we've been focusing on here is what the municipality can do as a whole, as opposed to individual homeowners with their own rain barrels. But as I mentioned, I'm planning a stormwater workshop later on in the fall, and that's one of the items we're planning on discussing. That happens, yes. Understood. Other questions? Sir.
Yes, sir. You talked about the core program that you're working on. Is there anything you're looking at for Wingate Road, Mark Avenue, and Maya Road? Because our yards are all swamps in the last 3 years since they did work on the Wingate Park area.
Okay, I'll tell you what. Could I talk to you personally about that later on so we don't take up everybody's time? Okay, great. Remind me, please. Okay.
Yep. Thank you.
All right, one more question.
I asked if you turned it off.
Okay. Anyway. All right. So I'm going to start off with the Parks and Rec update. My name is Ashley Moore. I'm the municipal planner. I'm first going to go over the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, or DCNR grant. They helped us pay for this park assessment. And then I'm going to go over the grant statuses for the proposed improvements for our parks. And then I'm going to call up Chuck Stober, who is our recreation director. He's going to show you pictures of the new park equipment that we have, some programs we have going on, and then the Bethel Park Community Day 2017. So the municipality was awarded a grant from DCNR to complete a park and recreation assessment. The reason for applying is that with the grant agencies, such as the state or the county, sometimes they require a potential grant project to be part of a comprehensive plan or a recreation assessment. So if we wanted new equipment in our parks, we needed to do an assessment first. We had members of a study committee that were selected. The study committee is a group of people who contributed to the planning process and helped us make decisions. It consisted of municipal staff, members of our planning commission, the recreation board, school district, and a council member. And this allowed for a variety of perspectives. The study committee hired a consultant team, Environmental Planning and Design. They're the ones who gathered the information, held the public and private meetings, and conducted key person interviews and created this report. So the intention of the assessment is it is a tool to inform us of what we need to do, what we need to prepare, upgrade, maintain, and enhance. So essentially, the assessment is to be used as a guide. So I'll go over a little bit some of the aspects of the assessment. We have our public outreach. We had public meetings held here at the community center in May and August of last year. We also had a public meeting before council in October of last year. Staff and the consultant attended community events such as Memorial Day of 2016, the Farmers Market, baseball games and softball games, just to get the word out about the study and about the survey. We did perform the online survey. It was on our website and was taken between March and June 2016, where 519 community-wide responses were received. So I'm going to go over a couple of the questions very briefly. We had 10 questions. Question one, how often do you or members of your household use parks and recreation facilities? Daily, weekly, occasionally, never visit or never heard of it. So most of the parks that were visited were Simmons, Millennium, Village Green, Miners, and Park Avenue. Now parks such as Shamrock, Pine Tree, Peter Page, Birch Tree, and Brookside, those are parks many people have never even heard of. Jumping to question five, there is a list of common recreation activities and facilities provided in the community parks. Indicate your level of interest in each one. Now, if you notice that the top choices in the dark gray for very interested, there's a splash pad or a pool, paved trails, outdoor court, and field sports. In the top choices for not very interested or in the light gray, you'll see a skate park, wildlife watch areas, and a dog park. We did a smaller scale survey for the residents around our neighborhood parklets, where 71 out of 300 responses were received. Key person interviews were held with council and our sports groups, and there was also a speaker at the Gold Card Club event. So here's a list of our parks. We have 14 municipal owned parks, and like I said before, a lot of people didn't know we had that many. So a little bit about the study. We have the park inventory and the analysis. Each park was visited multiple times, photographed, and documented. The consultant assessed things like the playground equipment, athletic fields, seating, and pavilions. And I'm going to use one as a brief example. We have Village Green. So the park was visited, we have a brief description, and current conditions were noted and assessed. So we did have recommendations for each park. Now for Village Green, I don't know if you can see that, but we have the improvements, the corresponding cost, time frame, and who's responsible. So, and again, I don't know if you can see, but we have noted there for Village Green, soccer, lacrosse fields, parking expansion, perimeter trail as part of the improvements. So here's the aerial view of Village Green. Now, as a direct result of the study and the surveys, we have a master plan. Now, every park in our study has recommendations, but not every park was master planned. As part of our grant requirement, we had to have a master plan, so we chose Simmons and Village Green. So if you're interested to see the recommendations for each park and the results of the survey, please visit the website under Parks and Leisure Services to review the assessment. So now I'm going to go over the current status of some of the grants we're pursuing. Since the study was approved by DCNR to be used as a guide, we are now pursuing some grant funding to make these improvements. For Village Green, the application was submitted to the state that would fund the improvements to the park for those two regulation and one practice size lacrosse and soccer fields. And also being proposed is that accessible trail system and a parking lot expansion. For Miners Park, an application was submitted to the county for baseball field improvement, a new walkway, and rehabilitation of existing concession stand and bathroom facilities. For our trail system, an application was submitted to the county for improvements to provide safer connections between the Montour Trail and South Park. So that connection will start from the Montel Trail section that is located near the intersection of Irishtown and Logan Road and will make its way to get to South Park and Corrigan Drive. And I don't know if I'm allowed to say now, but as of yesterday, we awarded that grant. Sorry, I just said it. It's good news, it's free money. Simmons Park, currently we do have a grant from the state, again, that's money in the bank, to fund new playground equipment and a shade structure at Simmons Park. So as part of the study, we did receive recommendations and a master plan showing a water feature at Simmons. And we applied for a county grant that would help fund that. Now, after some careful consideration, we're working toward moving that water feature to Park Avenue. So Park Avenue is more centrally located, has a better sidewalk network, closer to the community center and the light rail system. So we are actively working on making that adjustment with the pending grant applications. Also, the county grants that I mentioned beforehand, those are expected to be announced in mid-September. Some future funding that we're pursuing for those improvements are Park Avenue. We're still trying to shift some of those amenities from Simmons Park to the more centrally located Park Avenue. So that would include a statement playground piece in that possible water feature. And the existing T-ball field at Park Avenue will be relocated as to not displace those who currently use it. The next parks that could be in line would be Molly Hill with possible new playground equipment, pavilion, and a trail system, and then Millennium with possibly concession stands, restrooms, and playground equipment. Now I'm going to turn over to Chuck. He's going to show you some pictures.
Thank you, Ashley. The municipality did receive a grant from a gaming economic development fund grant from the Redevelopment Authority of Allegheny County for park improvements. The parks identified for these improvements were Simmons Park, Village Green Park, and Millennium Park. As you can see on our first slide here, this is our new sports court at Millennium Park. It's up off the Baptist Road entrance. When you go up the right-hand side, that hillside that was always, what do we do with this? Direct board and present the council a couple ideas, and I think this is a great addition to the municipality. And this is our 2 to 5 year old playground at Village Green that was finished last November, I do believe, with the safety servicing below it. It's the front playground as you come into Village Green. And that's another shot of the playground. This is the pavilion. We did do a pavilion up there with the grant money and our match. This is on the back side of the concession stand, and that's the 5 to 12 year old playground behind it. That's the another shot of the 5 to 12 year old playground. These playgrounds are spectacular. I think they're what everyone wants right now. I love the safety surfacing. The fit of the playground is great. Everyone did a great job picking it out. As you can see, that's a very well-rounded playground. Simmons Park, we put 2 pickleball courts in the old deck hockey deck there. And I can tell you it gets used constantly. People were like, oh, no one's going to use it. We were down there, I was down there last Thursday morning, and there's 12 adults down there lined up to play. 4 were playing at that time, so it is getting used a lot. And it's just a smaller version of tennis with the a wiffle ball and paddles. So it's the old paddle ball from the 70s. They just reinvented it, and it's the fastest growing sport in the country right now. They're adding like 150 associations across the country. We have started our fall programs. All of our fitness classes here at the community center will be up and running in the next couple weeks. Art classes, craft classes, our aquatics programs will be starting. We added a new pre-competitive swim team to the swim team. It's designed for the kids that are getting out of swim lessons and don't want to join or unsure about their skill level for the competitive team. This is a new stay involved, see if you want to keep going. Swim lessons start in 2 weeks up at the high school, and flag football signups end this Sunday, so please have your kids come out and sign up. Community Day is September 9th this year up at the high school campus. The parade kicks off at the municipal building at 9 o'clock. We will changing up Community Day this year a little bit. We're having a DJ instead of bands. We have the Polynesian Prince and Princess will be there to meet and greet the kids from 10:30 till 12:30. Then we'll have the male and female trolls in the afternoon from 1 to 3. We'll have a balloon twister at the recreation tent from 1 to 3. We just got confirmed the other day, Iceberg from the Penguins will be arriving at Community Day approximately at 2:15. Hopefully, maybe brings the Stanley Cup. I'd like to see that, but Bad Mixies, the remote control cards you've seen at all the summer festivals. He'll be up there all day. The Marines will have a dunk tank. Mayor Allen is here somewhere. He will be in the dunk tank. He graciously volunteered to go in from 10:20 to about 11 o'clock. Judge Arnone will be in the dunk tank from 11 to 12, and we'll see who else we can, you know, try to get in there after that. And they will have a Humvee. The fire department will be there, the police department, EMS will be there with their vehicles and talking to people. So come on out, Community Day should be a great day. And we have added the Rev 'em Up for Kids car cruise to Community Day. That'll be on the grass field across the street from 11 to 4. Thank you.
Thank you, Chuck and Ashley. Is there any questions in the audience for Chuck or Ashley? Yes, sir.
Recreation Aquatic. Is there any interest in having a kayak roll session in the pool?
We can look into that. I'll look into that. I'll have to make sure I have permission from the school district to do that. But that's something I can certainly look into. Get with me after and, you know, we can discuss it. It's a splash pad. It's a splash pad. It's not a pool. With the park study, we looked at adding some fields to Millennium, updating the concession stand, having enough fields to do a big tournament up there. Park Avenue's a T-ball coach pitch field. So okay. We talked to BBA, BCL, girls softball, all the organizations all the time. We're working with them to make updates. But it's going to take everybody to get involved, the organization, municipality, and everybody.
Before we turn it over, I did have one more thought. Just wanted to tell a little story. Whenever me and Chuck were doing some research for this assessment and for some of the equipment we're going to put in this park, we met one of our consultants in Simmons Park, and this was midday, and we were the only ones there, and there was a lady there with her two kids. But then when we went to go travel to see other parks, we did go to Upper St. Clair, we did go to Wiltshire, and it was full of kids, full of families. We couldn't find a parking spot. So, and I say that to say that we understand that our residents go to other neighboring communities for parks and recreation, but we're striving to be on a comparable level in regards to the level of service and the amenities being offered. So we want Bethel Park to be a destination, not just a place on the map, not just a place to drive through. We want you to stay here. So we appreciate your support and helping us get into that, to that level, and that we're just trying to make Bethel Park a better place to play. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ashley and Chuck. Next up we have Dennis and Jeff going to talk about some various code issues.
Yes, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dennis Smith. I'm the construction code official here at the municipality of Bethel Park. So in the next few minutes, I'm just going to briefly discuss my responsibilities here at the municipality. I'm going to discuss a little bit the permitting process, what requires a permit, why it's necessary. So to give you a little bit of a background of what I do, as far as the construction code official goes, I deal mainly with residential building inspections, plans examining for projects. So for instance, if you have a project that you want to have completed at your home, you would bring that in to start the permit process. I would take a look at those plans, review those to be code compliant, and then work with either the contractor or yourselves in regards to those drawings to make sure that they are compliant. And once a permit is issued, then I'll perform the inspections. And we'll get into that in a little more detail in a minute or so. Now, in regards to permitting, also part of my responsibility in the municipality is also verifying that the proper permits have been issued. For example, if a project is gone on or has been recently performed, we want to make sure that that project has gone through the required permit process and has been approved. So why is that important when we think about that? Well, there's many reasons why obtaining a permit is important. We'll discuss four specifically. Number one, when you obtain a building permit, that allows us to ensure that the construction is to code. And when we think about that, codes are written basically for the safety of the inhabitants or those who are using the project, whether it be an addition or a deck. So codes are very important when it comes to that. So we want to make sure that everybody is safe in that manner. So that's one reason for getting a permit. The second is we want to make sure that our residents here at Bethel Park are not being taken advantage of. Unfortunately, we have even recently come in contact with situations where a contractor would perform some work and not get the required permit, charge a lot of money to the resident, do the work in an unsafe manner, leave, and then now here you have a resident that has paid a lot of money and has an unsafe structure. So we want to be able to protect that. So when you or the contractor comes in for a permit, we're able to take a look at that, make sure that the proper insurances are in place, that are PA registrations to date and things like that. So it's actually an advantage to you guys as well. More than that, the third reason for obtaining a permit and the importance of doing so is it allows us to verify that whatever you're doing, whether it's installing a pool or building a shed, something to that effect, we want to make sure that it's not in a conflicting location. In other words, we want to make sure that it's not built in an easement or in a right-of-way or too close to a neighboring property, because that's only going to cause issues in the future. Unfortunately, there's been situations where a shed has been built in a right-of-way. In the future, that could mean that you'd have to move your shed or your pool if we have to access that right-of-way or that easement. And then lastly, as was discussed in the outset with John, we want to make sure that whatever is being constructed, whether that's an addition, a driveway, a garage, a shed, these are items that have impervious surface. So we want to make sure that it doesn't negatively impact the stormwater management here in the municipality. So what that means in applying for a permit is if there's a structure that's 400 to 1,000 square feet, then John's going to want to take a look at it, make sure that the proper drainage is working for the stormwater management. Now, if it's over 1,000 square feet, that's where it would require an engineer. You'd have to get engineered drawings to be able to make sure that the stormwater management is negatively impacted. So when is it necessary to get a permit? So it's a good question. Now, the definition given by the PAUCC, or the Pennsylvania Uniform Construction Code, which the municipality has adopted, as well as the 2009 IRC, it puts it this way. An owner or authorized agent who intends to construct, enlarge, alter, repair, move, demolish, or change the occupancy of a residential building shall first apply to the building code official and obtain the required permit. So that's a lot of words. Basically, if you don't know if you need a permit or not, the simplest thing to do is just call. With a few seconds, a minute, you can find out right away whether or not you need a permit. Now, there are three types of permits that the municipality requires. And if you haven't done so already, there's a flyer in the back. And those are kind of spelled out there in that flyer. But as far as the permits that are required, we require a building permit, a zoning permit, and an artisan's permit. And those are described in more detail inside that trifold flyer that we have. Now, there are a lot of, unfortunately, common projects that take place without first getting the proper permits and approvals. These are decks that are built that are over 30 inches high, porch roofs, drainage, whether that's foundation drainage, interior, exterior French drain, downspouts, any addition of those things, driveway extensions, sheds. A lot of times people may feel that they don't require permits, but they all do. It's just what type of a permit. So if you would give us a call, we would be able to direct you in the right area and help you out with completing the permit process for that. Which brings us to the next point, the permit process. So the permit process, in the majority of the cases, is very simple. And it's fairly quick and easy. There are several ways. The first thing that you would do is obtain an application. And there are several ways of getting an application. You can call in, and we can email you a copy. You can go onto our website at bethelpark.net and click on, there's a PDF there that you can simply print out and fill out. And then you can also just come in, which is especially handy if you have any questions. You can fill out the application, and I'd be happy to answer any questions at that time. Along with those applications, you'll receive a packet. For example, if you're building a deck, you would come in, fill out the application, you would get a deck packet. In those packets, whether it's a deck, a shed, a pool, an addition, in those packets, we'll explain exactly what you need to provide along with a copy of the residential permit application. And then once I receive all that information, I'd review it, and then upon approval, you'd be good to go. Now, the most common item that we need, whether it's a shed or a pool or something to that effect, would be a property survey. Sometimes we have those on file, but the best thing to do is make sure that you have that when submitting for a permit. So that's pretty much it in a nutshell. And as you may have noted earlier, and you will note throughout this meeting, that again, safety is of the utmost concern. And that really is the underlying goal of not only the construction code official, but also the code enforcement officer. And he will actually speak to you on a few items and how they impact our residents here in Bethel Park. So we'll now introduce Mr. Jeff Donatelli.
Hi, everybody. Sorry I don't have any fancy visual aids or anything like that, but the main reason I wanted to come here tonight is to make sure that everybody understands exactly what it is that I do, what the point of all of this is, because I know I'm the newest kid on the block. I've only been here 4 months. The position's only existed for 4 months. So whenever I was going through the interview process, I asked Director Arbaugh why they're adding a code enforcement agent now. He said that they've noticed certain declines in some areas of Bethel Park, and you guys are lucky enough to be in a municipality that's taken a proactive stance on that rather than a reactive one. They brought me in. The main reason that I'm here, the main reason for everything that I do, is to keep your property values up. People that are in this room right now obviously care. They're here. They do what they're supposed to. They're good neighbors. They talk to each other. They do what they're supposed to. Unfortunately, everybody doesn't always do that. And that's when I have to come in sometimes and give them a little kick to get them to do what they should have been doing in the first place. The general order of operations for any problems that I have is, first off, I would like everyone here to first go talk to your neighbor. If you have a problem with them, if you have anything that you're noticing, tell them, hey, this is happening, this is how it's affecting me. See if there's something that you guys can come to an agreement without even having me involved. Because a lot of times you've been neighbors for X amount of years and there's already some good faith built up there. If you've gone that route and it hasn't worked out, that's when you can please call me anytime. Let me know the address where you believe any violation might be or where a problem's occurring. I'll come out, do my inspection. If there's anything that warrants a violation notice being sent, I'll send it out the same day I do the inspection, tell them exactly what's going on, give them the steps that are needed to fix this problem, to get it up to Bethel Park standards, and give them an ample amount of time to do that. In a few rare cases, we have people that still just don't respond, and in those cases, unfortunately, I have to take them to court. But we're making it very clear that we're not going to let Bethel Park go downhill. You're all lucky enough to live in a great municipality, and I'm here to help keep it that way. Everybody on every street needs to do their part. Everyone needs to be a good neighbor. And that's what I do. Everything from whenever we see large trees that are dead, that are considered a safety hazard, safety violation, sometimes people don't see them. I bring it to their attention, give them a timetable, work with them, make sure they get a couple bids. Nobody's being rushed on anything. As long as I see some effort from you, see that you care, see that you're trying, I have no problem giving people ample amount of time to get things done. We do everything from that to handling dangerous structures, to handling the people who are buying property in Bethel Park and not maintaining it, just assuming that they're going to be able to sell it later. It's not going to fly anymore. I find the companies out. I find out a contact information. I get them, and I hold them to the same standards that I would hold anyone in this room and I would also hold myself to. So with that being said, I'm going to be here. Any questions that anybody has about anything, please feel free to come up and ask me one-on-one if you'd like, but what I would really like is everyone to come up to the microphone we have set up here and just ask your question where everyone can hear it. Because more than likely, whatever question you have, six or seven other people in this room have the exact same question. So let's get it out there. Let's make sure everybody understands what it is I do. If you have anything you want to even report to me right now, I can write on the back of my business card, keep it right now. I can give you my business card, get my number out there. That's about all I really have for everybody. It's short and sweet. So now I'm going to turn things over to our public works supervisor, Susan Doliner.
I do have some visual aids here. Where's the clicker? Hi, my name is Susan Doliner. I am a public works supervisor. I am one half of a team. Jim Atkins is my counterpart. We, between the two of us, supervise 19 employees. We maintain 12 square miles of roadway, three major parks, nine parklets. We take care of every street sign. We take care of three fire departments, maintain the building, the community center, the municipal building, and the new public works complex. My first picture here, that is our new street sweeper. It was just a year in February. That's $250,000 there. We send one employee out every Friday at 4 a.m. So if you hear that noise in the summertime, that's us. But it's the opportune time to get in because the cars are not on the roadway and the truck can really only go about 15 to 20 miles per hour to do a good job. So that comes out at 4 a.m. Friday. So if you hear them, that's us. The next one, that is our new John Deere roadside boom tractor. That goes out a couple times a month, we try to, and that it's a boom tractor. It cuts the vegetation along the roadways. That is one half of our snow fleet, which is currently off site because of the new construction with our public works complex. That's a jetter truck that maintains our sewer lines. That when we have any sewer backups, there's a crew that goes out and will clean the lines. And then every 6 weeks, we have some spots where we call 1% lines. The line's low. There's not a real steep grade. So we will send that every 6 weeks and clean. And that is one of our new salt trucks that has the tanks on board, like Sean had talked about earlier. That truck there, as it sits, is $166,000. When I became the boss 10 years ago, we were paying almost $90,000, and it's now at $166,000. When we go out in the wintertime, we send 13 trucks out with 3 spares. And just to stop some of the rumors, all our routes were computer generated. We had an employee that went into the computer, they put the boundaries of the municipality in there, and then each route would, because of the road miles, was divided between 13. So every truck has the same amount of roadway. And that's also from leaving the municipality and going into their district. On a regular call, if it's 3 inches or below, we can get those trucks or those roads clean in 2 hours to 2.5 hours. Also, all of our trucks now are equipped with the GPS system, so we can track them. So if a resident calls in and said, there was never a truck that went past or did my roadway, we can pull it up in the computer in seconds and give the exact time that that truck passed that resident's home. Our winter snow budget is $1.1 million. In a normal snow, we use about 8,000 ton of salt. We can house, now with the new salt shed, about 5,500 ton of salt at Public Works, on our complex. That's last winter, we didn't have a big summer or a big snowfall, so we have an abundance of salt that has to come in here for this year, but hopefully we won't have another big winter like we did in 93, that's for sure. When we send our trucks out, we throw 196 ton, and that's for a 2.5 hour call out. Anything over 3 inches of snow, our trucks go out with plows, and when the plow goes on, that means each truck is out for at least 6 to 7 hours. That's our employees constantly without, they can come in for maybe a half an hour break and keep going. They just keep on salting the road. So it's important that the residents try not to park on the roadways, to try not to park in cul-de-sacs to impede our trucks. That's especially when we're plowing, because it's too hard for them to maneuver around. The next thing we talk about is vegetation along the roadways. We ask the residents to cut back 4 feet from the curb line and 12 feet high. If our salt trucks come in, and even with the school buses, when they come in along the curb and they to plow, we're breaking the mirrors. A mirror on that truck is $500. Because it has heating elements inside. So it just takes one branch, and they're traveling maybe 20, 25 mile an hour, it smashes the mirrors, and then we need to replace that. And again, trimming of vegetation along stop signs and street signs. We asked the residents, if everybody did their part and took the time to trim, so when you're coming down the roadway, you have visibility, then that just takes a lot of work from our guys. Plus, it's easier. I guess some people get unhappy when we trim your trees. We send letters. We ask you to do it. If not, then we have to send Jeff Donatelli, the hammer, out to talk to you. So we ask you to do that. Again, with storm basins also, if you have a storm basin that adjoins your property, we ask you to keep the debris off it. Don't put your grass clippings in it. We have residents that weed and throw their grass clippings on the storm basin. That's really bad, because it gets in and then it'll clog up and flood your yard or the neighbors downstream. I guess that's it for me. Does anybody have any questions?
Okay. Is there a possibility of getting the, I don't know what kind of
Right now, we currently don't do that. I mean, we can look into that, but we don't do that right now. We do leave pickup with the recycling. Thank you. In the back. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a sign there that says people have to go up on the tracks. Well, that's pretty obvious. Everybody has to go up on the tracks when there's traffic coming up and down the street. And that creates a gridlock there. And I know when I come down there sometimes, I'll go up to the other intersection because it's dangerous.
I am not the person to ask, but I will forward that information. I think that might go to Chief O'Connor or to Port Authority.
To where?
To the county.
Okay, because I know other people have the same concern.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions? We just started our line painting. We usually start it in the middle to end of August, so we just maybe haven't gotten there yet. Any more? Oh. I would have to defer that to the police department. I think Chief O'Connor, we would maybe be able to address that. We don't make the claim to put them up. Okay.
Yeah, those are private roads at this point. They will be dedicated over to the municipality, but they haven't been at this point. So before they are dedicated over, we will make sure those signs are installed. Millennium?
Millennium Court is top NFL parking and so is Millennium Drive.
I'll look into that. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Is that all? I'm going to pass it to Chief O'Connor.
Why don't we just take a quick 5-minute break if you want to get a beverage or a donut, and then we'll come back and Police Chief and Nora Helfrich will speak.
Next up, we have the Police Chief O'Connor and Director Helfrich to talk about the heroin epidemic, a very important topic and affecting our community in many ways. So I'll turn it over to them, and they're going to tell you all about it.
Thank you. Good evening, Chief here. Chief Nora is with me. And why we're together is because we work in conjunction on this very serious problem of heroin. And heroin, which was once a very inner city urban problem, is now more of a way more a suburban and rural problem. Heroin distribution in this country is primarily controlled by the Mexican cartels. So if you saw the old Godfather or French Connection movie, those people were passed from the scenes. There's still some trafficking there, but the Mexicans are pretty much developing a stranglehold on this distribution. It comes through the south, southern states, it's up in the Midwest, comes into Mid-Atlantic, and it's all the way up into New England. And they don't come here and sell it themselves, they distribute it to dealers, primarily gangsters in our urban centers who then get it out to the suburbs in rural America. Why we're having so many overdoses now is because the heroin is becoming increasingly mixed with fentanyl. And this is leading to the increases in the overdose and subsequently the deaths. Chief Heltro, she can speak to why that affects the body like that. When we here in Bethel Park are not immune. We are seeing over the past 2 years significant increases in overdoses from heroin and heroin laced with fentanyl. For example, 2016, we had 5 overdose deaths. Bethel Park police officers started carrying Narcan at the end of October. We had our first deployment on the 31st of October, and we had 11 total deployments of Narcan from Halloween till New Year's Eve. This year, 2017, we've already had 6 deaths and 13 Narcan deployments, and we are 2/3 of the way now through the year. A couple things. Our oldest victim was 64 years old. That was a death. We had our youngest victim who survived was 20 years old. One of the things I want to point out, we have not had anyone in their teen years, including high school years, who has overdosed in 2016 or 2017 on heroin. We're not arresting people in that age bracket for possessing heroin or paraphernalia associated with heroin, such as needles or stamp baggies. So it's usually when we encounter someone who has overdosed or has in possession of heroin, they're 25 years or older. And I know there's some people out there that are trying to, for whatever their agenda is, to say that it's a high school problem. It is not. We're not seeing that. And having said that, though, we are always on the awareness for that age bracket, but fortunately right now we haven't seen it. What do we do to address this problem? In late December of 2015, Bethel Park Police, we created a drug task force. All 5 of our detectives are on our department drug task force, along with some select members of our patrol division. Our administrative lieutenant is in charge of it. And we work in conjunction with the Pennsylvania State Attorney General's office and their detectives, and we've been able to make several arrests. In December in 2015 on Main Street, we arrested people by the name of Toombs and the home owner, Mr. Bowes. We were working with the district attorney's office to seize the house when Mr. Bowes sold the house. They are out of there. In October of 2016, we arrested a Robert Moore of Castle Shannon in Oak Tree Park. He was attempting to sell heroin. In November of 2016, we arrested a Mr. Glenn Perella of Brady Place and Deborah Taylor of Carnegie. We allege that Deborah Taylor brought heroin, sold it to Mr. Perella, who then gave it to one of the visitors at his home, a Shannon Fashion, and she died on his floor. Both of them are arrested for drugs, and working with the district attorney's office and the state attorney general's office, we have charged both Mr. Perella and Deborah Taylor with drug delivery resulting in death. So Mr. Perella has made bond. The last I knew, Ms. Taylor was still in the Allegheny County Jail. May of this year, we arrested Ashanna Farnan of Clairton for selling heroin in Bethel Park. In May, we arrested Mr. Jeffrey Sabrowski of First Don and Mine 3, selling heroin. And in June of 2017, we arrested Brandy Snowden on Walnut Street for selling heroin. We're working to get her evicted. So our efforts are ongoing. I put their names out there. If they don't like it, sue me. One of the things we're also seeing from this heroin epidemic, that a lot of people, it impacts us in a couple other ways also, our merchants out here. Because these people need to sustain that habit, they're constantly coming out and stealing things from our stores, selling them so then they can go buy heroin with the proceeds. Another problem is, now that it's being mixed with fentanyl, it possesses a serious risk to first responders, police, medics, fire personnel. If you can see this, just this month in August on the 9th, 18 members of the Pittsburgh Police SWAT team were contaminated when they were executing a search warrant on a drug house and became exposed. They got on Mercy Hospital and be decontaminated. So we've done some things here and try to make the officers safe. They carry gloves. We have masks. I'm going to show you some of these. We stopped field testing drugs that we find. We used to have a kit and we could test it and see if it's positive. We don't do that anymore. So we get it sent down to the Allegheny County Crime Lab and let the professionals do it in a controlled environment. We also, our managers and elected officials gave us money and we bought a thing called a drug hood. It's kind of like a stand like this and it has a top over it, and when they are packaging their drugs, there's a fan and they can do it under there and get sucked up into the filter, any residue or fumes. It's very good tool for us to have. And we also have extra Narcan around the station in case worse would come down and somebody would be overdosed. We have Narcan. And all of our officers are trained by her and her staff to deploy Narcan. So I'm going to show you some of these things here.
Hold this shot. Thank you.
Welcome.
This here's basic gloves. Everybody carries these basic gloves on, just like you'd see in a hospital. They shouldn't be touching anything they find, stamp baggies or syringes or anything, when they go to a scene of an overdose or a drug call. I carry them myself, right in my pocket. That's our mask, and this is what do you call that?
An N95
mask. It's a really good mask, and it's sort of a certain way you've got to put it on. And again, Tri-Community South came up and they trained all the officers how to get this on, make a tight seal, so they're protected from that. The other thing I'm going to pass out is, this is what Narcan looks like. I'm going to send it around. It's not going to hurt you. And I mooched this from UPMC. This isn't yours, so.
Yeah, we don't carry that kind. The Narcan that the chief has, the officers themselves purchase that particular brand. That is not what they're carrying in the police cars provided by EMS. They have special kits for that. Narcan is becoming more expensive. And as you know, there's no charge to the heroin users. And so now it's becoming a financial problem and hardship for police departments and EMS services for that.
Yeah, just pass it around. Everybody take a quick look at it, and then I'll come back, pick it up at the end. It's not going to hurt you. And again, I'll tell you, our efforts are ongoing. There's not a day that I don't think about how we can stop this. You know, sometimes I think it's like shoveling crap into the tide and it comes back on you. But we go out the next day and we'll do it again. We'll save people's lives. We'll arrest people. And until this stops, you know, we're not going away and we'll deal with it. So you have my pledge on that. And that's just about what you're going to hear from any other chief of police or officer on America.
So we have this heroin epidemic, and a lot of people don't even know what heroin is. It is a narcotic, and what it does is why the Narcan works. And Narcan will only work to reverse the effects of the narcotic, okay? So we can administer it by intramuscular or nasally. The police do not have needles. We don't want them doing that. So we give them a device that they can ingest the, give the Narcan through an atomizer in the nose. One of the problems going on is the chief talked about fentanyl, but there's also carfentanil. If you haven't heard about that, it comes out of Japan, and that is a drug that veterinarians use to put down large animals, tigers, elephants, okay? That is some bad stuff. And you don't know what it's laced with until it's too late. The size of a pinhead, if these officers touch carfentanil, fentanyl will put them down. And they have to be able to give Narcan for the, each other. So I did a, worked with, Lieutenant Babin on a policy to protect the officers. So Tri-Community not only has to protect Bethel Park, but we have to cover Upper St. Clair and South Park as well. So we're responsible for 80,000 residents and 33.5 square miles. All the police officers are charged, trained in Narcan, the N95 mask, the gloves. We don't really want them touching anything, and now they want them wearing a gown to protect themselves. The chief's telling you about the overdoses of heroin. It's cheap. It's like $5 to $8 for a bag of heroin. But it's also complicated by the fact people are stealing, which the chief touched on. And there is a huge mental health issue going on in the country. So a lot of addicts have mental health problems. We did a panel discussion a couple months ago with the Attorney General, and one of the issues is there's nowhere for these people that want help with their addiction to go. They're overflowed, the addict is waiting, and it's days or weeks, and there's nowhere for them to go, so they feel hopeless. One gentleman said to me that the only time that he has any peace at all and feels like a human being is when he does that heroin for that short window of time. That is the only time he feels like a human being. The chief touched on the teenagers. I can tell you, because we track every overdose in Bethel, Upper St. Clair, South Park. That information is given to the chiefs collectively by me, and that goes to the center in Cranberry. And one of the things is the heroin bags have markings on them, and that's how they can tell where that distributor is from, correct? The various markings. And then they got smart and started not putting markings on the bag. Well, for some reason, they're back on again. So we document all that for the police departments. It's amazing how many families and parents, professional people, doctors, lawyers are purchasing, because you can buy the Narcan yourself, and administering it prior to the arrival of the police officer or EMS, and we get there and they're conscious, alert, and oriented, refusing to go to the hospital, and 2 hours later we're back again for another overdose. After another. And then we transport the patient to the emergency department and they sign themselves out AMA. There were two brothers in Bethel Park, known heroin addicts, and the one was one of our deaths in Bethel. And you would think his brother would wake up and get into rehab. No, he's still out there doing heroin. The other issue is reimbursement for EMS. It is costing thousands of dollars. So you bill the insurance company, and Highmark Insurance will send the check directly to the patient. So now the heroin addict who has Highmark and we transport, they get a check for over $1,000, they cash it, and they never pay for their bill. And we've fought that on a federal level, state level, and lose every time. So it's causing a huge cost factor. EMS is strained to begin with. Tri-Community is running 25 to 30 calls a shift, not a day, a shift. There's no mutual aids to call back in because nobody's going into the profession. Our mutual aid services surrounding us, they're calling us, we're calling them for ambulance transports. For various reasons. There's an increase in suicides as well. We just had another one yesterday, okay? So an awareness is number one. If you could please be aware. You touched on CPR. That is true. Yesterday we had a CPR save at Giant Eagle. That was a beautiful thing. Did I tell you about that? Giant Eagle had an AED in their store. They have a team that actually responds. They responded, had the AED on the patient, were doing CPR and got the patient back. And we had an off-duty medic there who was just happened to be shopping and offered to help. And they're so proud of what they do. They said, no, no, we don't need your help. Okay, so it was great, okay? And they did a beautiful job. And the gentleman, when I checked today, is still alive. So we have never, remember the Attorney General didn't believe me, we have never had a drug overdose in any one of our school districts in 40 years. We've been in service 40 years. I've been here 39 and a half. And in our school districts, none. Do we have a drug problem? Yes. I can tell you as of today, we have had a total of 65 heroin overdoses since January 1st. In all three communities, and six deaths total. However, if you looked at the TV today, what did the city of Pittsburgh say they had? 200 and hundreds. So our communities, thank God, are nothing compared to other communities, okay? The oldest overdose we had was 72. And we're finding that healthcare workers coming into people's homes, they're going in there to take care of your relatives, sit with them, you know, play cards, whatever. And they're stealing the elderly's drugs and then using them. Okay? So it's just crazy anymore. Yes, how about some questions? How many know what heroin is? Sean, what's heroin? Remember? Go ahead.
It's a white powder.
Yes, it is. Very good. It is a white powder. And so you don't think anything of it when you see that white powder. And so when you're a first responder going to respond to help somebody, do you think they're paying attention to that white powder? No. Because what do they want to do? They want to get the patient out of the out of the car. You know, maybe it was an accident, whatever. That's the last thing. And that's how an officer in another community got overcome by heroin, because it was on the seat. And it's airborne. That's why we trained the police in the N95 mask. Very fine particles, okay? Almost looks like powdered sugar. Go ahead. Any questions? Yes.
Have you
Yes. But that's regulated, and it currently we're not permitted to do that. See how Epi's so expensive? Narcan is going to be the same. That little dose of Narcan the chief passed around, that's $110 a dose. Okay? Not including the syringes and the atomizers. We also cover the county park in South Park. And 2 weeks ago, I had one of the lieutenants call me at 6 o'clock at night and say, Nora, can you help me? I'm like, sure, what do you need? Narcan. I said, what? Narcan. They get their Narcan from the district attorney's office. They had given so much Narcan, I forgot to tell you about that, that they were out of it. So I had to give them Narcan just to get through their shifts to protect themselves. Anybody else? Yes.
These are pending cases. So out of the names I gave you, they're all in the pipeline. Yes. Yes.
Do you know what the signs of an overdose are? We'll go into somebody's home. They call for the overdose. They're standing there, and the next thing we know, they're going down a notch for the count as well. Pinpoint pupils, okay? And they're not acting correctly. And if you look in their eyes and they have pinpoint pupils, that's a sure sign of a narcotic overdose. But keep in mind, Narcan will only work on narcotics. Do you see how they're blaming the emergency rooms for this epidemic now? I have to participate in a lot of studies. Less than 1% of all narcotics in this country are being prescribed by emergency room physicians. Less than 1%, but they're making it out that this problem came from there. In addition, now they're targeting orthopedic doctors. What the public isn't realizing is the poor cancer patient. So you know how it's difficult to get your prescriptions filled and you have to go to the doctor? What about the poor cancer patient that's been on a narcotic for maybe 2 years, now has to find a way to drag themselves out of bed to go to their PCP every 30 days to get their prescription refilled, okay? It's just a huge problem, one thing after another. Any other questions?
Stay focused on heroin, yes. Yeah, we're not taking anything beyond the heroin problem tonight. Sir?
And they have a database now with these computer systems, so not just here, you can, if before the doctor prescribes the medication, they're able to tell if they were already given it somewhere else. So it's working, we do know that.
The connections that people are making, the body drops, is it in this community?
I think the majority of our users here go somewhere. They go to like the Clareton, they go into the city and they bring it back. We, like I said, some of the people we have arrested, we have caught coming out here to, you know, to make the sale. But a lot of it is our people go in and then they bring it home and use it in the privacy of their confines at their home.
Anybody else have a question? Thank you.
Thank you. God bless.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Now we're going to open up the floor to some general questions and answers. I will ask that you grab the microphone just so everybody can hear what the question is. I'm going to start. I had a few questions emailed to me and dropped off in the office, so I'm going to knock out just a few quick ones to get those going here, and then I'll turn it over to everybody else. But wrong paper. Okay, may a resident make an appointment to visit with me? Absolutely. Please give me a call and we can definitely set something up to meet. Are you addressing poison ivy in the parks and playgrounds? Yes, we are. We do spray for poison ivy in the parks and playgrounds. Are signs such as "We Buy Gold" permitted on utility poles by ordinance? They are not allowed and we pull those off. And I'll do one more. When should political signs be removed from the public right away after an election? We typically give them 10 days to remove that sign. Okay, we'll take some questions from the audience. Anybody have any general questions on any topic we discussed tonight or anything else that you're just desiring to know about Bethel Park? Yes, sir. Could you please step to the mic just so everybody can hear? Thank you. Yes, the complaints are logged in. Depends on the specific complaint. Sometimes we just get a general, there's a pothole on X road. So sometimes some complaints aren't logged that are minimal in nature or not followed up on. We just go take care of the action if it's something we can do fairly quickly. More comprehensive complaints are logged, assigned to a property address typically, depending on what the complaint is. We typically have a better response time than 8 days. Recently, we did have some flooding issues, so we were a little backlogged. We did address kind of the more major issues. Some of the other complaints were addressed. It took a little bit longer than 8 days. Typically, we have less than 3 to 5 day response time. Okay, any other questions? Yes, sir.
To all the folks sitting in this audience this evening, come and join the Bethel Park Historical Society. Go to the website, just type in Bethel Church, Bethel Park Historical Society. Bring it up on your screen, and then come to a meeting. You'll find us on the Park Avenue with Street Park Front Yard. That's us. Join us, please. Come.
I will say the Bethel Park Historical Society has done a lot with the old schoolhouse. It's an amazing, the renovation that took place just in the year that I've been here. Definitely recommend going to see it and a great cause. And thank you for the efforts you put in down there, sir. Okay, anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
Question is, who do we talk to about getting a turn signal from Broughton Road to get onto Library. Because often, because there's so much traffic, you can't turn the other direction when you're coming out of your driveway, so the best thing to do is to go down to the light at 88 and then make a left. And again, the traffic coming the opposite direction is almost as bad, especially during rush hour times. So we really do need a left turn signal from Broughton on to 88. Thank you.
Yep, we can take a look at that. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Two boys that play travel baseball, and we've been traveling throughout the Pittsburgh area, and we've been to affluent communities and we've been to not so affluent communities, and it just seems like even the not so affluent communities are having a better fields than we do. And you know, we pay a lot of taxes for our fields, and the BBA and everybody has their own. We pitch in as much as we can. I'm not saying that, you know, we need a concession stand. A bathroom would be great in some of these places, maybe even some lights. I wanted to say that, you know, we appreciate if, you know, we could get the grass cut a little bit more often, especially at Oak Tree Park. When all the little white flowers come on, when it starts growing, and there's a lot of bees, and the kids have to come off the field because they got a lot of bee stings and stuff like that. So it would just be nice to have it kept up a little bit more than it has been.
Thank you. Yeah, we put a lot of efforts this year into some fields at Millennium and Simmons with some laser grading, some new infield, and some different weed management and vegetation management techniques that we're using. That didn't extend to Oak Tree at this point, just because we're kind of under a testing period, and we want to see, make sure this works before we spend the additional monies to really do this everywhere. At this point, there aren't any plans to have any restrooms like at the Oak Tree facility, but we are thinking about expanding baseball fields up at Millennium, where there are concessions and restrooms, and we actually. This year, we've done a lot better job on the fields than previous years, thanks to Susan Dahlner. And one of the things that we're doing is assigning staff to certain parks, so they take really responsibility for that park. And it's been, we've seen a lot better at our main parks. You know, and maybe we need to do a better job at our smaller parklets. So thank you. Yeah, and here it's a challenge because I think we have 14 fields, and like Upper St. Clair's five, and they're all in the same spot. Ours are all over the municipality, so it makes it just it's a really difficult situation. That's why we're hoping to kind of make Millennium more of a baseball park, and that way we can put our resources there. So, but thank you for the comments.
Well, first, welcome to Bethel Park.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
To hear more about your ideas of a walkable Bethel Park. Tell us about that.
Well, we do have many ideas, and I want to just comment that it's me and staff, we're in council. We all have this, we're trying to create this vision of walkable Bethel Park. So one of the first things that we looked at is what's called Active Allegheny Grant, which Ashley kind of alluded to earlier, but we were just awarded that money to help design and facilitate a means of pedestrian access from the end of the Montour Trail over to South Park on Corrigan Drive. So that is something that we're going to be actively looking at. As long as council approves accepting that award, then we're going to actively pursue that, and design phase will start on that project. Additionally, one thing we're working with is the Friends of the Montour Trail. They have some really great ideas to also expand the Montour Trail in a different direction, bring it up close to Lytle Station, and then kind of continue in all the way to Millennium Park. They have a pretty solid plan in place, and some things have to happen, but we're working with them any way we can to help assist that.
One other thing we're looking at, we're doing kind of a new program with our roads called Robotics this year. It's a kind of experimental program. It's really cheap, which is nice, but it's experimental. And one of the things we're looking for that is to see where our sidewalks are and where our sidewalks aren't to help start connecting the dots and making things better throughout Bethel Park for walkability. So thank you. Any other questions out there? Comments? All right, well, thank you very much. I really appreciate you attending this evening. Thank you, staff. I really appreciate you guys giving your presentations and taking your time. We're gonna stick around for a few more minutes, so if there is something specifically you wanted to ask one of the staff members, myself, please feel free to just grab us and we can talk through anything. Thank you so much for attending. I really appreciate it.